is just hackers. But here to help us better understand the current political climate is Erin Elmore, a Republican strategist and the executive director of the grassroots organization USA Strong. So, Erin, we just played that clip of Joy Reid making a comment that a lot of people in the media are even admitting that it was a little bit Islamophobic, asking for her to apologize. But it's interesting, too, the lack of scrutiny that's going into that comment. And it does shed the bigger picture of what's happening regarding political bias. So I want to get your broad thoughts on how the media will play into this upcoming election. Do you expect them to kind of carry water for Joe Biden most of the way?
I mean, I think it's well known that Joe Biden and the media are simpatico. Everyone other than a few people really are just have it in the back of them. They hate President Trump. The vitriol is apparent. The double standard, you could cut it with a knife. It's so thick. It is absolutely crazy what is going on. And this is what happened exactly going into the election in 2016. It is by the grace of God and shocking that President Trump pulled it off. There was no one on his side. Social media did not say things properly in terms of what Donald Trump was promising to the American people. The broadcast news stations did not say things fairly and in an unbiased fashion. I expect nothing less right now. And going up to the election on November 3rd, it is going to be vitriol and nasty all the way down to the wire.
And Erin, you touch on a pivotal point, and it's the idea that even the president uses Twitter, for example, to reach a majority of his followers. But it even speaks to a bigger issue as well. For example, when the RNC numbers came out, they were a little bit lower than the DNC numbers. But I think that speaks not to necessarily the enthusiasm, but to the idea that Republican and conservative voters don't really watch mainstream media outlets. In fact, when you go online, as you mentioned, whether it's Facebook or whatever, there is a platform there for many conservatives that are talking about these ideas that aren't being talked about on mainstream news. So do you think that there's a greater digital emphasis this year?
I do think there's a greater digital emphasis. But what also is the Cato Institute had a poll or a study that came out recently that said that over 60% of Americans are afraid to talk about their political beliefs. I think there's something to be said about that because these aren't Democrats. The Democrats are the one who are pointing their finger and banging their fists and screaming all day. The Republicans have been scared into submission because we don't want to lose our jobs. We don't want to get harassed when we're going out to a restaurant. I think that number is staggering, and it's going to really make sense on November 4th when President Trump pulls it off.
And building on that point, Erin, there was another study that Bloomberg was touching on late last week, and it was the idea that twice as many Republicans are likely to lie about their political affiliation or who they're voting for than Democrats. And that is something that's pretty alarming to me because when you look at polls, for example, they're already polling more Democrats than Republicans. And the suggestion that almost 10% of Republicans could be lying about their affiliation could cause all these polls that we're seeing right now into disarray. So do you think that the polls are once again missing the point?
I mean, history is clearly repeating itself. Anyone that's going to start an argument about the polls right now is setting themselves up for disaster, especially on the Democrat side. We know what happened last time around, and it's happening again. And I also think in terms of the strategy, the Democrats are doing the same thing they did in 15 going into 16. Joe Biden wasn't showing up. Neither was Hillary. They're having that same strategy of not really going to places. And he's doing it under the guise of Corona. She did it under the guise of ego. I think that he's running a campaign very similar to her. And I think there is going to be a massive upset because they haven't changed their strategy. All they are continuing to do is say, you're racist. You're racist. And that's kind of worn off because everyone on the right now is like, you've called me a racist so many times. Everyone knows it's not true. It doesn't have the same impact anymore. The playbook from 16 should be thrown out. But hey, good for the Republicans that it's not.
I think you're exactly right. And in fact, even Joe Biden himself kind of reflects what Hillary Clinton was, an extension of the Obama era neoliberal type of policies that were rejected in places like Wisconsin, Michigan, Ohio, even Pennsylvania. I mean, it's something that we're seeing the same thing kind of play out. And you mentioned the idea that Joe Biden is doing the same thing as Hillary Clinton, kind of staying away from the media, staying away from the attention. And that is something that proved to be detrimental for Hillary Clinton as well. So this time around, I know that it's a different race. We have the coronavirus pandemic. We have unrest on the streets, which is facilitating the president's numbers in the polls. Is there anything to suggest that this race will have a different outcome, or should people who are Republicans and conservatives be optimistic right now?
I think the conservatives should absolutely be optimistic. The only way, in my opinion, that Donald Trump will not win is if the Democrats cheat. I don't put cheating above them, but the only way President Trump will not get reelected is if the Democrats cheat. The suburban housewife, if you will, or the suburban female voter is a very targeted demographic. No suburban voter right now is happy with these riots, the looting, the unrest in the streets, the mob, the defund the police. They are all going to vote Republican. And by the way, these people want their children back in school. I am a mother of a child that goes to a suburban school, and only 15% of people chose to keep their children at home. That tells you something. That should send a pretty clear message. More people than not want to go back to life as normal. And I think hurting this even more are these Democrat politicians like Nancy Pelosi getting her hair done, but telling everyone else to stay home. Where I'm from in Philadelphia, Mayor Kenney dining inside, but he won't let us dine inside. These things are really upsetting the voters.
I think you're right, and I think people see the disconnect between what Democratic politicians are saying you should do and what they're doing themselves. And I mean, it happens on the Republican side as well. It just happens with politicians at every level. When there's a disconnect, though, the people start distrusting what those people are saying. So I think in this case, it's going to backfire on Democrats a little bit more because they're the ones who are saying that you can't go to work, you can't go to church, things that are negatively affecting the voter. So I think that's something that at some point they're going to have to face the consequences for. But Erin Elmore, I really appreciate you coming on tonight and breaking down the state of the 2020 race. Thank you.